Welcome to a lesson on the Shapley-Shubik Power Index. The Shapley-Shubik Power Index was introduced in 1954 by economists Lloyd Shapley and Martin Shubik. It provides a different approach for calculating power in a weighted voting system that is different than the Banzhaf Power Index. In situations like political alliances, the order in which players join an alliance could be considered the most important consideration. In particular, if a proposal is introduced, the player that joins the coalition and allows it to reach quota might be considered the most essential. The Shapley-Shubik Power Index counts how likely a player is to be pivotal. But what does it mean for a player to be pivotal? First, we need to change our approach to coalitions. Previously, the coalitions containing players 1 and 2 and players 2 and 1 would be considered equivalent since they contain the same players. We now need to consider the order in which players join the coalition. For that, we will consider what's called sequential coalitions, where sequential coalitions are coalitions that contain all players in which the order of players are listed reflect the order they joined the coalition. For example, the sequential coalition here, containing player 2, player 1, and player 3, would mean player 2 joined the coalition first, player 1 joined second, and finally player 3 joined third. The angle brackets are used instead of curly brackets to distinguish sequential coalitions. And now let's define a pivotal player. A pivotal player is a player in a sequential coalition that changes a coalition from a losing coalition to a winning one. Notice there can only be one pivotal player in any sequential coalition. Let's determine the pivotal player in the weighted voting system for each sequential coalition. So we'll add the weight of each player in each particular order to see which player allows the coalition to reach the quota, in this case of 16. So player 3 has a weight of 7, so we have 7 plus the weight of player 2, that would be 8. 7 plus 8 is 15. We still don't have quota. And then player 4 has a weight of 3, so plus 3. Notice that player 4 brings the total weight to 18. And now the coalition reaches quota, and therefore player 4 is the pivotal player. Looking at the next sequential coalition, we first have player 1 that has a weight of 12 plus. Next, player 2 joins a coalition with a weight of 8, and since 12 plus 8 is equal to 20, notice after player 2 joins a coalition, the coalition reaches quota, and therefore we say player 2 is pivotal. Now let's go over the steps on how to calculate the Shapley-Shubik Power Index. Number 1, we list all sequential coalitions. Remember, these coalitions contain all the players. 2, in each sequential coalition, we'll determine the pivotal player. 3, we'll count how many times each player is pivotal. And then 4, we'll convert these counts to fractions, decimals, or percentages by dividing by the total number of sequential coalitions. But before we do this, we need to mention one more thing. If a weighted voting system has n players, then there are n factorial sequential coalitions. So for example, if a voting system has 5 players, there would be 5 factorial sequential coalitions, where 5 factorial is 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1, or 120. So now let's take a look at our example. We want to find the Shapley-Shubik Power Index for the given weighted voting system. Notice how there are 3 players, and therefore there are 3 factorial, or 6 sequential coalitions given here. Remember, for a sequential coalition, the order matters. So the coalition in the order of players 1, 2, and 3, then the coalition of players 1, 3, and 2, then the coalition with players 2, 1, and 3, then the coalition of players 2, 3, and 1, and then finally we have the two sequential coalitions where we have players 3, 1, and 2, and then players 3, 2, and 1. So we've done step 1, we've listed all the sequential coalitions, and now for each sequential coalition we'll determine the pivotal player, or the player that changes the coalition from not meeting quota to meeting quota. So for this first coalition, we have player 1 first, which has a weight of 17, plus the weight of player 2, which is 13. Notice how once player 2 joins a coalition, the coalition has a weight of 30, which meets quota, and therefore player 2 is pivotal. Next order is player 1, player 3, and then player 2. So player 1 has a weight of 17, plus the weight of player 3 is 10. Well, 17 plus 10 is 27. So player 3 turns the coalition from not making quota to making quota, since the quota is 25. So player 3 is pivotal. For the next coalition, we have player 2 first, which has a weight of 13, plus player 1 has a weight of 17. Notice player 1 makes the sequential coalition meet the quota, and therefore player 1 is pivotal. Next we have the order of player 2, player 3, and player 1. Player 2 is 13, plus player 3 is 10. Notice how here the weight is 23, we still have not met quota. It takes player 1 to join with a weight of 17 for the coalition to make quota. This would be 40, which once again makes quota. So player 1 is pivotal for this order. Next, player 3 has a weight of 10, plus player 1 has a weight of 17. Notice how when player 1 joins, the coalition meets quota at 27. So player 1 is pivotal. And then finally, we have the order of player 3, 2, and then 1. Player 3 has a weight of 10. Player 2 has a weight of 13. Still have not made quota. It takes player 1 to join with a weight of 17 to make quota. So player 1 is pivotal. Now we'll count how many times each player is pivotal. So player 1 is pivotal here, 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 and here, so 4 times. Player 2 is pivotal here only once, and player 3 is also only pivotal once. Notice how the sum of the number of pivots is 6, so the Shapley-Shubik power index for player 1 would be 4 divided by 6, or 2/3, which is a percentage, would be approximately 66.7%. The power index for player 2 would be 1 divided by 6, or 1/6, which is a percentage, would be approximately 16.7%, and the same thing for player 3. Remember, the power index can be expressed as a fraction, decimal, or percentage. I do want to take a moment and mention that the Banzhoff power index and the Shapley-Shubik power index are usually similar. However, since the two approaches are different, the values are often slightly different. For example, if we were to calculate the Banzhoff power index for the previous example, notice how the power index values are slightly different using this method. We won't take the time to calculate the Banzhoff power index in this lesson, since we already learned this in the last lesson, but notice how these values are slightly different than the values that we found using the Shapley-Shubik power index. Here are the values for the Banzhoff power index, and here are the values that we found using the Shapley-Shubik power index. I hope you found this lesson helpful.